is good to see faces in the audience, I have to say. In the past year and a half, I think us musicians really realized that music is at its most powerful when it's shared in person. And I'd like to extend a sincere thank you to Dr. Kathy Chan for making all this happen, all the hard work that she put in. Now, tonight's program also came with a very, very long set of program notes, which you do not have. So I will be walking us through this program. This program was conceived for last year's 250th celebration of Beethoven's birthday, when everybody was playing concerts of nothing but Beethoven. So I thought to myself, what better way to celebrate Beethoven than not playing Beethoven? And all jokes aside, Beethoven as a composer, there are far and few between composers that leave such a lasting impact, not only on audiences, but also his peers, his successors, all of the music world that came after him. And it is through this lens that I thought it would be an interesting way to explore and celebrate the great man himself, and by playing music that was inspired or borrowing or utilizing Beethoven's music in some fashion. So tonight we begin with Robert Schumann's Opus 17, Fantasie. Now, the Opus 17, Fantasie was one of Schumann's greatest large-scale works, and as a man, first and foremost of letters and words, he quite characteristically appended a motto to the first movement, which reads, from the German poet Frederick Schlegel, which reads, resounding through all the tones of the earth's many-colored dream, there sounds a faint, long-drawn note for the one who listens in secret. Now, the reductionist idea about what this faint note is the quote at the end of the movement in which Schumann quite literally quotes Beethoven. Which is from Beethoven's song cycle, An die ferne Geliebte, or To the Distant Beloved. Now, Schumann was very fond of these kind of word games, and this was actually a reference within a reference, referencing his to-be wife, Clara Wieck, who at that time was separated from him. And there was an immense pining for her presence, which really manifested in all of this music. Now, the quote is ingenious, not simply because he happens to channel Beethoven, but in fact, it's how it's arrived at. The quote is at the very end of the movement, not at the beginning. Your typical theme and variations or what have you would put the theme at the beginning and the composer would then unravel it. In this, the theme is at the end. And in doing so, Schumann takes all his own materials, all his fragmentation of this music, putting it before it, so that we as audience members and me as the pianist arrives at Beethoven through Schumann. And this is a fantastically ingenious way of using borrowed material, and in many ways perhaps elevated his ability to write in such a large-scale form. Now, Schumann was well known for struggling with large-scale forms, but this ingenious, somewhat sonata form with some caveats, is one of his most successful enduring large-scale works. So without further ado, the Opus 17, Fantasie, first.
Thank you.
not every quote or allusion was chosen out of poetic sentiments. The following piece, John Corigliano's Fantasie on Ostinato, uses a quote from Beethoven as a sort of solution to a problem, a compositional problem. In his own writings about this piece, Corigliano admitted that this was, for one, his first foray into using minimalist techniques, and also his criticism of minimalism as a musical style that lacks structure. And so who better to impose structure than the master of structure himself, Beethoven? And so the quote that the Ostinato, if you will, is the obsessive and incredibly famous theme to the Allegretto of the Seventh Symphony. And through this very simple theme, Corigliano spins out an entire fantasy. Now, this theme was quite brilliantly used by Leonard Bernstein to demonstrate Beethoven's greatness in this wonderful interview. You can find it on YouTube. Where he talks about what makes Beethoven great. And so he says, is it the melody? There is no melody. Is it the harmony? Just fives and ones, very simple. Is it the rhythm? Well, that's self-explanatory. So if you look at each individual element of this music, of this movement, this incredibly famous movement, none of this sticks out. But what is it? What is it about Beethoven that was so special? Now, Bernstein said he knew how every note should be followed by the next note. And in his estimation, this was form. This was the mastery of form. And in his words, it was as if he had a telephone line to heaven. This piece, so, is it more apropos to find a quote from a master of form for Corigliano to impose form on a style that he thought was so severely lacking in it?
Thank you.
sure everybody is no stranger to Schubert. Franz Schubert, writer of many songs and essentially compatriot of Beethoven. He outlived Beethoven by 1 year, succumbing at the tender age of 31. Schubert was frequently anxious. He was an anxious man. And also, he was keen on leaving his own impact on the music world, which was increasingly difficult sharing a city with the great Ludwig von Beethoven. And in fact, apocryphally, he's said to have uttered, after Beethoven, what is left for us? And so, the music of Beethoven weighed heavily on Schubert's mind. And in fact, perhaps none so heavily as the Seventh Symphony that I just played. Schubert, this dactylic rhythm, this long, short, short, was a rhythm that would become, through his own voice, characteristic of Schubert's. And it was something that was kind of obviously a tribute to Beethoven. In fact, as early as his Opus 7, the Death and the Maiden song. This rhythm would become, in fact, a calling card of Schubert's. And in the impromptu that you're about to hear, what was somber, it was the voice of death, becomes. Or in the earlier set of impromptus. So, as you see, these references are not by accident, especially towards the end of his life in the last 2 years, 27, 28. Schubert embarked on a project of sorts where he started composing in the genres that Beethoven dominated. So the symphony, the string quartet, the piano sonata. And it's very interesting and very telling that in a lot of ways, the most successful, the most endearing in the works that survived the longest past him and were collected and studied by his successors, the Romantic composers, were in fact these smaller pieces, these quote-unquote character pieces, which would give rise to the character pieces of Schumann and Brahms, etc. So this is Schubert, D935, Impromptu. Thank you. Perhaps more than most, Brahms was deeply, deeply affected by Beethoven. At the tender age of 20, he arrived at the Schumann household, and he had made a massive, massive impression on Schumann and his wife Clara. And in his zeal, which Schumann was really known to, he was, he kind of flew off the handle quite a bit, wrote this very famous article titled Neue Bahnen, or New Paths, in which he proclaimed Brahms to be the successor to Beethoven. Imagine that, age of 20, and your respected idol and hero says, here you go, live up to Beethoven. That's a lot. And so Brahms was saddled with this expectation for his entire career, and it really did prove to be both a challenge and an inspirational force for him. For example, his first symphony took him 20 odd years to write, and revise, and rewrite, and revise, because he knew that in publishing a symphony, in daring to enter the genre that Beethoven had mastered, he was really making a statement. And so even this Opus 5, Piano Sonata, this behemoth of a piece, written specifically right around the time that Schumann wrote that Neue Bahnen article, is very much an ode and a little bit of a working out of his own anxiety about Beethoven's influence. The very second phrase, we are already treated with not one, but two references to Beethoven. It's very obvious. On the right hand. It's very obvious what shadow is over him in this piece. Now, it's all over the piece. It's not just the first movement. In fact, in the second movement, in the beautiful Andante, even here, we see a shadow of that theme, now, of course, transformed and hidden. There it is. And then again, in the third. As you astute listeners might have noticed, this sonata has five movements, which is a bit odd. And this one, this Rukupi, looking back, a reminiscence, is really the odd man out. And it's really in the Rukupi that Brahms not only references Beethoven, because it's all over the place, in the bass, but he is trying to one-up him in a way. In the last movement of the Ninth Symphony, before the theme proper, the Ode to Joy, Beethoven recounts and then rejects all of the themes of the previous material. Now Brahms thought, I'm going to do that, but I'm going to put them all together. So, second movement. Major material that had previously been exposed and worked on comes to a head here in the Rückblick. Now the real magic happens in the last moment. In the last moment, there's no Beethoven. In fact, he borrows a theme from his violinist friend, Joseph Joachim, who later he wrote the violin concerto for, and his personal motto, which is F-A-E. Or in German, frei aber einsam, which is free but alone. How poetic. A last moment where there is no Beethoven, as if he walked himself out of that influence, and he's proclaiming to himself, more than anybody else, but really to himself, that he's free. So this is Brahms' Opus 5, Piano Sonata.
Thank you. Thank you.